Thanks, everyone. It's great to be here. And today we're going to hear a little bit about how we can traverse the world and all its biodiversity through some of the amazing institutions and museums we have right here at Harvard. Here's a picture of me teaching a few undergraduates in my ornithology class in Palo Verde National Park, Costa Rica. And one of the things I want to impress upon you is that I think the most important thing you can do after taking classes wherever you go is to get involved with research. Many of the classes that we have here in biology and environmental sciences, we won't be just talking about the problems out there. We'll be visiting them and looking at them directly. And this is one of the great aspects of teaching here at Harvard is the ability to really give students a first row seat to all the really incredible changes that are happening to our planet right now. Now, in addition to all the great students and all the great faculty we have here at Harvard, the bottom line is that Harvard also has a lot of stuff. We have millions of specimens in various kinds of museums. We've got art museums, natural history museums, ancient Egyptian museums. All of these are freely accessible to Harvard students. And for teachers like me, they allow us to unveil the amazing world of biodiversity by really traversing the planet right in the confines of Harvard campus. This is the venerable Museum of Comparative Zoology, which is the largest university-based natural history museum in the world. You can see here, we're able to look at the subtle variations that occur in species across the landscape. We can look at living species, such as the orioles you see on the top row, or we can look at extinct species, such as the Carolina parakeets, which you see on the bottom left. We also have incredible resources in genomic resources. These are tissue or blood samples from species sampled all over the planet that allow us to probe the genomes of these extraordinary species. Through that, we can understand how these species have changed through time and how they're responding to pressing issues like climate change. You know, I view specimens not simply as a particular bird or a particular insect or a particular plant, but really as snapshots of biodiversity of a particular place in time during the history of our planet. So for example, on these extinct Hawaiian honeycreepers, well, some are extinct, others are still with us, we can find, for example, pollen from flowers that they have pollinated. We can find chemical residues of chemicals that have wafted into the Hawaiian Islands over time. We can use high energy physics to look at the nanostructures of their feathers to understand the colors that they produce. And so a specimen is not simply a bird or an insect. It's really a window into an historical place and time. Here are just a few examples of some of the field trips that we take as part of our classes. We've got field trips here from ornithology, from herpetology, which is the study of reptiles and amphibians. We've also got botany in the lower left, and we have paleontology, the study of fossils. These field trips are an integral part of the classes that we teach and allow students to visit the sites where many of the great discoveries are made. We also strive to give students the skills to record biodiversity in ways that will allow researchers from around the world to harvest that information. And so here you see a student taking sound recordings of a bird singing. It's actually a really challenging thing to do. As you take your recording, you become attuned to your environment and you realize how many planes are passing over, how many folks are talking right next to you. It's really a challenge to get a really pristine recording of a species. We use scopes and we catch birds with mist nets to look at their details very closely. So here's a picture taken by a student on one of my trips of the white-collared manakin, which is a species of neotropical bird, which is found in Panama. And I thought I'd show you a quick clip of what this bird does when it's excited, getting together with other members of its own sex. So you can see it's a so-called lekking species. meaning the males actually display communally. Now you can see that this student has actually lost sight of this really interesting bird. She's trying to find it, and eventually, and this really illustrates some of the challenges of studying animal behavior. It's not easy. It's not a laboratory-controlled environment. But you can see that eventually she does capture it again, and we were really able to witness some remarkable behaviors this way. We also do a lot of cool stuff at night. For those of you who are night owls, ornithology is the place for you. This is a common parakeet, a very interesting nocturnal species that feeds on insects. And we also find lots of other creepy crawly things like spiders. Here's a bunch of students just grooving out on a spider on the road at night. Now, we also get a little bit crazy on these trips. And here's a video that my students put together having fun.
As a biologist, I know how important it is to bring students into the field, to make them see the diversity of birds, to come to places like Costa Rica, and most importantly, talk birdie to me.
Get chirpy on them. I'm that flight that you get on. International. Fold out seat in my thrifty. Riding bumpy roads. Cause I know all the birds.
Okay. They need a little work on their harmony, but you can get the sense. So I just wanted to end with two little vignettes of research in my laboratory. And again, both of these projects were actually done by undergraduates. And one of the best things about being a Harvard professor is to welcome students into the lab. And that's honestly the best way you can get value for your college education. So the black-footed albatross, this is my favorite bird, so you don't have to ask me what my favorite bird is. This is it. It's a really interesting seabird, a member of the albatross family, which in this case breeds in Hawaii and in Japan. You can see that, you know, its population numbers are not particularly high. There's less than 100,000 of them on the entire planet. And their movements, these albatrosses are famous for traversing the globe seemingly effortlessly, raise an issue about how we can best conserve them. And so, for example, the black-footed albatross is found both on islands of the so-called Leeward Hawaiian Islands, which are the many small islands and coral atolls to the northwest of the main eight Hawaiian islands. So when I go to Hawaii, I don't go to Waikiki or Kauai even. I go to Midway and Turn Island, which are these remarkable atolls to the northwest that you see there. They breed there, and they also breed islands in southern Japan. And so these are, it's an incredibly widespread species. And in fact, individuals will fly all the way from Hawaii to the west coast of North America just for a meal for their chick. And so we need to know how genetically different are populations in Hawaii and Japan, and should we manage them as a single unit or as separate units? Well, an undergraduate took this on and applied high-throughput genetic techniques, and she found that, as you can see from this plot, we can easily separate the Hawaiian and Japanese populations on the left and right side of the graph. So this tells us that, in fact, these populations are genetically differentiated and that we might want to consider managing them separately according to their own life histories and ecologies. And then finally, I just wanted to mention a really interesting project where we're using an animal model to understand the spread of zoonotic diseases. Very much a simulation as if we were studying COVID in humans. So house finches are a very common species here in Massachusetts. And about 30 years ago, they were invaded by a bacterial pathogen called a Mycoplasma. And you can see the spread of that pathogen up on the map there. And we've essentially been taking museum specimens going back in time to study the bird before the pathogen spread. You can see there on the blue on the map, as it was spreading in the east, and then finally as it continued to spread through the west coast. Using museum specimens, we can essentially go back in time and look at this process historically. And this is, I think, one of the great values of these amazing collections. So I just want to suggests that you come here, you'll go far, and that biodiversity needs the best and brightest minds. And we've got some great resources on campus to do just that. So thank you very much.